Eradicating poverty is the central goal of development policy and requires understanding what causes poverty and why it persists. Broadly speaking, there are two views as to why people stay poor. The first argues that the poor have the same opportunities as everyone else, but lack the traits or abilities needed to capitalize on them. The second argues that the poor face different opportunities because they are born poor. Specifically, there may be a wealth threshold below which people are stuck in a poverty trap. While those above the threshold have the means to pursue high-earning occupations, those below are consigned to low-earning jobs that keep them in poverty. In this view, individuals are trapped by their initial wealth rather than by their traits or ability. From a policy perspective, this is a crucial distinction. The presence of poverty traps would suggest that efforts to reduce global poverty should focus on policies that move people over the wealth threshold and into more productive forms of employment. This paper tests for the existence of poverty traps by studying a large randomized asset transfer program in rural Bangladesh. BRAC's Targeting the Ultra-Poor program offers households a one-off transfer of productive assets, most commonly a cow, with the goal of creating a source of regular earnings for poor women. The authors estimate the short and long-term effects of these transfers and track 6,000 poor households from 2007 to 2018, half of whom were randomly selected to receive a cow in 2007. To provide context, this figure shows that the baseline distribution of assets in both treatment and control villages is bimodal. Households in this setting either own a lot of productive assets or have almost none. Those at the bottom own mostly poultry and goats, while those at the top own more expensive assets, namely livestock and land. These differences in asset ownership give rise to differences in occupation. Wealthier households use their assets to engage in livestock rearing and land cultivation, while the poor engage in low-earning casual wage labor, which doesn't require assets. This bifurcation suggests that the BRAC transfers, which are large enough to move poor households in treatment villages to a different part of the asset distribution, may allow the poor to grow out of poverty by giving them access to the more productive occupations of their wealthier neighbors. And when estimating the program's causal effects, the authors do find patterns consistent with poverty trap dynamics. Because households differ in their baseline wealth, they also differ in their post-transfer wealth, and the results reveal a threshold below which treated households are more likely to slide back into poverty, and above which they are more likely to escape it. This threshold is slightly more than the median value of a cow, and the difference roughly equals the value of a cart or shed. This suggests that households who have access to complementary assets are better able to turn the BRAC transfer into a sustainable and productive investment. For example, households who own a cart are able to sell their livestock products at distant markets for better prices. On average, and over the 4 years following the transfer, beneficiaries who are below the threshold lose 14% of their assets, while those above see gains of 16%. This divergence continues to widen over the course of 11 years, as those above the threshold acquire additional livestock and, remarkably, land. Over time, a greater share of their earnings derives from livestock and land cultivation, occupations they were previously excluded from. These long-run dynamics underscore a key point. In the presence of poverty traps, one-time transfers can lead to permanent reductions in poverty. The poor in this setting are not constrained by some fundamental trait. Rather, they are excluded from more productive occupations by their inability to make a large enough initial investment. Once this constraint is removed, they transition from casual wage labor to more profitable occupations and escape poverty. In line with this, there is substantial labor misallocation at baseline. Estimates from a model of occupational choice indicate that absent constraints, 90% of poor households in this setting would optimally specialize in livestock rearing, and only 2% would specialize in casual wage labor. But the actual distribution is wildly different. Credit constraints prevent the poor from adopting the occupation where they would be most productive, and in monetary terms, the resulting misallocation is an order of magnitude larger than the one-off cost of moving households over the poverty threshold. More broadly, these findings imply that efforts to address global poverty should embrace big push policies that enable occupational change. In the presence of poverty traps, large one-time transfers that move people past the poverty threshold can be more effective than the smaller-scale continuous consumption support programs that are currently the norm. To read more on this topic, you can check out the paper's references to other related work. This includes research on poverty traps, the efficacy of big push policies, and asset transfer programs in particular.